to Studio 5. Many couples see the same arguments bubbling up over and over again. My next guest says the solution is creating a better harmony in your relationships and in your home. Studio 5 relationship contributor Dr. Matt Townsend says there is a musical analogy to learn from here. You are bringing us a little culture.
Yeah, I'm big time cultured.
Are you?
Actually, no. I quit piano like 3 times.
You did? You started and stopped 3 different times.
I could not commit. But I did, not to brag, and this wasn't going to be part of this, but I was part of the accordion orchestra.
You're a liar. You really,
no,
you really
totally,
were?
Yeah.
At your high school?
No, it was at an accordion school.
Oh.
Larry Pino's accordion school.
This is where you need to go like this with your glasses.
I know.
So that we know you're that kind of a nerd.
I wasn't a nerd. I was probably, I don't want to brag, but I was pretty much the hottest guy in the class.
I'm sure you were. I don't doubt it. Your kids, picked up and followed in your musical footsteps.
Yeah. They too are maestros, like they used to call me. But I have a son who... You couldn't just sit and play with a teacher like normal. We have one daughter that plays really well, is professional,
right.
Gets paid a lot of money to teach and to play. And she just learned it kind of down the line in a very classical kind of
through
musical
the book,
way.
Sitting at a piano, practicing hours on end.
My son couldn't do it. He just, it was too much pressure. It was too weird. It wasn't his way of learning.
But he was talented.
Super talented. Probably uber more talented than anyone in our family. And what he did is we just quit paying for lessons. And we thought that would motivate him to work harder.
Uh-huh.
But he didn't. He just sat down and started learning by ear. And now what he can do is play any song. He hears 1 minute of a song and can play any song by ear.
He's amazing. He's played at a few of your date nights.
He has.
And he's
the bomb.
Yeah.
And he's all over YouTube and stuff. So Tanner's his name.
Uh-huh.
So we went and we wanted to give him the skills that he needed. Because classical, kind of linear. So there's two types of approaches when we're trying to learn music. I mean, this is my little accordion methodology.
Right, right.
There's kind of the classical version. And then what I would just call is the improv, okay? The ability of the classical is, it's, you know, there's kind of a right way and a wrong way to perform. It's very controlled. It's kind of what you'd see at the symphony.
Uh-huh.
There's compositions, there's music, there's notes. You have to be disciplined enough to focus and do it, but you have to do the music by the book.
And then there's Tanner's way, the improv
Tanner's way.
Track.
And the improv way is kind of no right or wrong way to do it. It's much more felt, so your discipline isn't necessarily to do it and to have to sit down and be disciplined to do it. It's to actually be disciplined enough to just let yourself go, to go where the music is. And he'll be able to find it with his ear. He uses his moods more, he feels feelings more. It's much more by gut. And I have people all the time saying, well, Tanner's amazing, but you really need to have him learn some music. And I'm sitting there thinking, shut your cake hole. Can I say that? I just said it. Are we taping this?
I think it's recorded.
But shut it. Because it's his way, right?
Yeah.
It's his way. So he may not ever play at the Met. I don't know if you play piano at the Met. But he may never
play. We could go to Carnegie Hall.
Uncouth I am. But he's going to play it his way. And so what I found is sometimes when we're trying to have we have an issue and we're trying to solve it with our partner, some of us have a very formal way that it has to happen.
They're classical.
That we're going to fix it.
Yeah.
And we're going to follow the notes and we're going to get it and we're going to do it properly. Which usually involves always talking, always now, always in the moment.
You're looking at the women of the world, I can tell.
We call you women.
Yeah.
And then there's the improv, the one that maybe you just need to feel your way through the conversation. Maybe we don't need to talk about it all today. Maybe we could just get the conversation started. Maybe we don't have to do it at 9:30 or 10 or 11 o'clock at night.
Yeah.
Maybe we could go to bed and wake up in the morning and do it, but we're gonna feel our way through it. So to solve a problem in this upcoming date night, what we're gonna talk about is how you create harmony between two different opinions,
and
two different positions.
I love the word harmony. It's one of those words, I like it because it sounds like what it is.
Yeah.
But it's kind of a missing link, a missing characteristic, not only in our relationships, but in our homes, right? We're so crazy and frantic and busy. We could all use a little more harmony.
And we're so into our notes, and we're like, if you can't get into my note and create something beautiful, then we don't, there's that dissonant sound. There's the sound that doesn't sound so great.
Right.
What I found, though, with some of the experts that have sat down with Tanner to teach him, Tanner can start wherever he wants to start, and these experts can jump right in and improv with him. And if he goes down, they'll go up. And if he goes up, they'll go down. And they just move with him instead of having to be rigidly doing it your way.
Mm-hmm.
And that's part of what I want to try to teach with communication is it's almost a free flow where if you're good enough at the principles of it, you can go wherever the other person's going and be able to create something pretty powerful and
beautiful. So how can we bring that free flow into our marriages, our relationships, our families, and get more harmony out of it?
4 basic steps that have to be in the space. I liken it to like a jazz ensemble that's going to play like a really good jazz. jazz band in some dark basement bar.
And they're going to rock it.
And they're just going to, and they just kind of feel their way through it. First thing, you have to have the safe space. So the space has to be safe enough for both of us to be able to actually offer what we can offer, okay? Because if it's not safe, I'm going to hold my talents back. By the way, if it's not safe, I'm going to hold my ideas back. Mm-hmm. If I know that whatever I say is not going to jive with what you believe, with what you think, with what you know, with what you want, then I'm going to start to hold back. So we need a safe space. That means maybe the right time, the right way, the right place, a place where both of us agree none of us are going to run, and we're not going to allow it to fight and escalate.
And does tone come into that? Because you can get
tone
the judgmental.
Mm-hmm. Uh-huh. Mm-hmm. You did
and
what?
And shut it all down.
Yeah, and so some of those are very subtle things like questions. Neither one of you should be leading. There's not always a leader in a jazz song, right? There's just, we'll have one person that might be the starting point, and then other people will start going off from that, but eventually someone else might take the lead for a while. So we need to allow some of the rules to just float. But we're going to stay in the space together.
Which, again, I'll say it, women are the masters at getting in there, scooping it up, and giving it structure and uniform formality, right?
Which is, and it's a beautiful thing.
Well,
as long as you give me room to move in your structure.
Yeah.
As long as I've got freedom to shuck and jive. I don't know if that's the word.
That works.
Share and listen with courage. So imagine that now we're in this space. You have to be willing to offer your thoughts. And sometimes that takes courage. Mm-hmm. And sometimes it takes more courage to actually hear them. So I need to have the courage to actually share what I need to share, and you have to have the courage to hear it. You have to have the courage to hear me say what I'm not liking. And I have to have the courage to say it. What happens in our relationships? We never have the courage to do it. That's one of the number one killers. We don't have the courage, or we do have the courage, but we don't have consideration when we say it. So we say it in a very rude way.
See, courage is an interesting word to me, because you're talking about in the space of a marriage, someone that you are the most comfortable with, you are hopefully the most safe with.
This is your best friend on earth.
So where does courage
Courage is saying, I don't want to be at the reunion, hypothetically.
Yes.
I don't want to go there. I'll go there for 7 days, but I'm not going nine. I'm not. 9 days is too long of a reunion.
Right.
And it's the courage to hear that and not think, see, you don't love my family. So if all of a sudden you jump into your own idea, you're not hearing me.
Yeah.
The minute you're already preparing your retort, you're no longer listening. So you have to have the courage to stay in that space and actually hear. And don't just hear what I'm saying. Hear what I'm feeling. Hear what my intent is. My intent is not saying I hate your family. I'm not saying I hate your family.
Yeah.
I'm saying 9 days is excessive.
Yeah.